Srimad Bhagavatam, Canto 1, Chapter 2, Text 6. Please repeat. Savai Pumsam Paro Dharmo.
Savai Pumsam Paro Dharmo.
Yato Bhaktir Adhokshaje.
Yato Bhaktir Adhokshaje.
Ahaituki Apratihata.
Ahaituki Apratihata.
Yayatma Suprasidati.
Yayatma Suprasidati.
Savai
Pumsam Paro Dharmo.
Yato Bhaktir Adhokshaje.
Ahaituki Apratihata.
Yayatma
Suprasidati.
So I do the translation and purport. Translation and purport by His Divine Grace, A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada, Jaisala Prabhupada. The supreme occupation, dharma, for all humanity is that by which men can attain to loving devotional service unto the transcendent Lord. Such devotional service must be unmotivated and uninterrupted to completely satisfy the self. Please repeat. The supreme occupation, dharma,
for all humanity,
is that
by which
men can attain to loving devotional service unto the transcendent Lord.
Such devotional service
must be unmotivated
and
uninterrupted to completely satisfy the self. Purport. In this statement, Sri Suta Goswami answers the first question of the sages of Naimisharanya. The sages asked him to summarize the whole range of revealed scriptures and present the most essential part so that fallen people or the people in general might easily take it up. The Vedas prescribe two different types of occupation for the human being. One is called the Pravritti Marga, or the path of sense enjoyment, and the other is called the Nivritti Marga, or the path of renunciation. The path of enjoyment is inferior, and the path of sacrifice for the supreme cause is superior. The material existence of the living being is a diseased condition of actual life. Actual life is spiritual existence or Brahma-Bhuta existence, where life is eternal, blissful and full of knowledge. Material existence is temporary, illusory and full of miseries. There is no happiness at all. There is just the futile attempt to get rid of the miseries, and temporary cessation of misery is falsely called as happiness. Therefore, the path of progressive material enjoyment, which is temporary, miserable and illusory, is inferior. But devotional service to the Supreme Lord, which leads one to eternal, blissful and all cognizant life, is called the superior quality of occupation. This is sometimes polluted when mixed with the inferior quality. For example, adoption of devotional service for material gain is certainly an obstruction to the progressive path of renunciation. Renunciation or abnegation for ultimate good is certainly a better occupation than enjoyment in the diseased condition of life. Such enjoyment only aggravates the symptoms of disease and increases its duration. Therefore, devotional service to the Lord must be pure in quality, that is, without the least desire for material enjoyment. One should therefore accept the superior quality of occupation in the form of the devotional service of the Lord without any tinge of unnecessary desire. Lead one to perpetual solace in his service. We have purposely denoted dharma as occupation because the root meaning of the word dharma is that which sustains one's existence. A living being's sustenance of existence is to coordinate his activities with his eternal relationship with the Supreme Lord Krishna. Krishna is the central pivot of living beings, and he is the all-attractive living entity or eternal form amongst all other living beings or eternal forms. Each and every living being has his eternal form in the spiritual existence, and Krishna is the eternal attraction for all of them. Krishna is the complete whole, and everything else is his part and parcel. The relation is one of the servant and the served. It is transcendental and is completely distinct from our experience in material existence. This relationship of servant and the served is one of intimacy. One can realize it as devotional service progresses. Everyone should engage himself in the transcendental loving service of the Lord, even in the present conditional stage of material existence. That will gradually give one the clue to actual life and please him to complete satisfaction. Thus ends the Bhaktivedanta Purport. Om Ajnanatimirandhasya Jnananjana Shalakaya Chakshurunmilitam Yena Tasmai Sri Gurave Namaha. Namo Vishnupadaya Krishna Preshthaya Bhutale Srimate Bhaktivedanta Swamin Iti Namine. Namaste Sarasvate Deve Gauravani Pracharine Nirvisesha Sunyavadi Paschatya Deshatarine. Jai Sri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Sri Advaita Gadadhara Sri Vasadi Gaura Bhakta Vrinda. Hare Krishna 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 Hare Hare, Hare Rama 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 Hare Hare. Krishna Prabhupada. So this is the definition of pure devotional service given by Srila Vyasadeva. Our acharyas have defined pure devotional service similarly. Narada Muni has defined in a particular way. Anyone recollects what Narada Muni says? Sarvopadhi, sarvopadhi vinirmuktam, tat paratvena nirmalam. When our upadhi, sarvopadhi, vinirmuktam is cleansed, and tat paratvena nirmalam, when we become nirmala, peaceful, with eradication of the contamination, in that stage, when we render devotional service, when we render service with our senses, Rishikena Rishikesha Sevanam Bhakti Ruchyate. That is a pure devotional service. So first there is purification, and then there is actual engagement of the senses. So until the purification happens, it is only conditional happiness. The senses are engaged in what is perceived as happiness. And Vyasadeva here is giving it slightly different and similar definition. Savai pumsam paro dharmo yato bhaktir adhokshade ahaituki apratihata yayatma suprasida. For a living entity to become blissful and happy, the way to become that is to engage in ahaituki apratihata devotional service, unmotivated and uninterrupted. Now, Rupa Goswami has synthesized all these definitions given by our previous acharyas and came up with one brilliant definition of devotional service, and that is anyabhilashita shunyam gnana karmaadi anavrutam anukulyena krishnanusilanam bhakti uttamam. If you see in the purport, Prabhupada actually explains that verse, even though he doesn't quote it. He explains the meaning of what Rupa Goswami, how Rupa Goswami has synthesized all these different aspects into one simple definition. Anya abhilashita sunyam. Our anya abhilashita, our different desires, which are different from devotional service. Anya abhilashita sunyam. What are these anya? What are these other abhilashas? It could be jnana based or karma based. We may have something to get in return for our devotional service, or even something to gain as knowledge in return for devotional service, so that we can show off or we can feel happy personally because of acquiring those particular things, not necessarily as a service to the Lord. Gnana karmadi anavrutam anukulyena krishnanusilanam bhakti uttamam. And the devotional service should be anukulyena. Anukula means favorable to Krishna, not unfavorable. What Krishna wants, not what we want. What we want, we still do it in the name of doubting. That is in the initial stages. But when we become perfect, completely pure, we execute what Krishna wants. So here, in the purport, Prabhupada mentions two paths typically used for progress towards self-realization. One is Pravritti Marga and Nivritti Marga. Pravritti Marga is basically living entities who are still pious but want to be under the control of the Vedic literature. The Vedic literature, particularly the Karma Kanda sections, which prescribe certain regulations and still the path of enjoyment, like the rituals of marriage and doing certain kinds of yajna for achieving something, putra kameshti, for health or for prosperity or for even societal happiness. There are so many rituals in Karma Kanda. So that is called Pravritti Marga. You are still enjoying Pravritti, but slowly you will come to the point of self-realization. So in the Varnashram Dharma, you are engaged as a Brahmana, Kshatriya, Vaishya, Sudra, and go through different stages as Brahmacharya, Grihastha, Vanaprastha, and Sannyasa. And by taking this path prescribed in the Vedas, one is supposed to be gradually cleansed. And in the end, he is supposed to take this Nivritti Marga, which is a life of renunciation. But Krishna consciousness allows us to tread the path of Nivritti Marga right from the beginning. We don't have to wait for the official Varnashram Dharma to take us towards the end of life and then take up the path of self-realization. So Krishna consciousness affords us to be in that path right from the beginning. And it gradually takes us from conditional state to transcendence. Last Sunday, one devotee asked me a question. What she was saying was, sometimes we ask Krishna for something because we are struggling, our family is struggling, we are undergoing so much of distress, and it may happen that Krishna never grants what we want, in spite of us desperately needing it, desperately wanting it. It doesn't come. You don't see the reciprocation from Krishna. And it becomes very disappointing and disheartening and depressing at those times. Why doesn't Krishna reciprocate if we are his devotees? All I am wanting is to get me out of this trouble, from this extreme situation. I am not asking for my sense pleasure. So how can we understand this? So I was explaining to her about how when the requirement for purification, there is also pain. If you go to kitchen after our Sunday feast, there is a lot of cleansing that needs to be done, especially those stovetops. Lot of grease, lot of remnants of food, you know, sticking there. You need strong chemical and for it to, you know, absorb, and then you need to scrub it with heavy things. So the stovetop feels pain. If you ever went to the, or obviously you might have gone to the doctor for dental cavity cleanup or root canal treatment, of course they give you some kind of, you know, numbing, but still after the numbing you start to feel the pain. So the deeper is the contamination, the deeper is the pain. In fact, in material existence, Prahlad Maharaj says, dukkhau shadam tadapi dukkham atadhiyaham. What does it mean? Dukkhau shadam tadapi dukkham. The aushada for dukkham, the medicine or remedy for dukkha, is even more painful than the dukkha itself. Dukkhau shadam tadapi dukkham atadhiyaham. I had a Western colleague in my office. He sits right next to me. He comes once in a month from his home in Oregon. And he carries a small pack with him always. I was always intrigued by what is in that pack. And then he would take that pack and go somewhere and then come back in the middle of the day. And then I asked him what it is. I couldn't withstand that intrigue. And he said he had a high stage of this diabetes, and it's in a higher stage. He needs to be on medications and restriction. He doesn't have lunch, he only has some nuts. Very high restrictions. And then he showed me that box where he carries some injections, and then he injects into his stomach that insulin. And just by hearing it itself is so painful to me. And how he is enduring that pain day in and day out to get over his disease, his distress. The remedy, if you want to get rid of the distress, is more painful than the distress itself. And if you have a boil on your hand or body, the surgery is more distressful. You need to be admitted, you need to be given this numbing, and then you need to heal that process. So this material world comes with a package. You cannot have happiness without undergoing any of this distress. So I was also giving her the example of, to whom I was answering the question, the giraffe, the mother giraffe, when she gives birth to a baby giraffe, something very peculiar happens. As soon as the baby giraffe is born, the mother giraffe kicks the baby very hard. The baby goes up in the air and falls down. And then the baby giraffe will be wondering, what kind of world have I come into? It was all secure inside, even though it was dark. But I thought I would see light and happiness. Now I start getting kicked by my so-called mother. What kind of world is this? And before he even comes to his senses and comes out of the shock, the mother again kicks him. Again he goes up in the air by several feet and falls down. So this process happens a few times before the mentality of the baby changes. I need to become strong, I need to become hard. And the next time the mother is about to hit him, he starts running out of fear. And the mother becomes very happy, very joyful. Now my baby is immune to the attacks of these wild animals. He can save himself. So the pain was required because the mother knew, it seems the flesh of the baby giraffe is very tasty for these tigers and lions, the wild animals. They are especially after it. So the mother knows what needs to be done. She cannot protect all by herself. So the baby has to cooperate. And for that, he needs the treatment. And so all that process that is done so that the baby becomes proficient, becomes sufficiently equipped to deal with the world. We need to also understand about, Prabhupada also talks here in the purport about the conditional stage of happiness. Conditional means we become conditioned to a particular kind of atmosphere. For the spring break, one day I took my son to a park for playing. Park meaning some kind of a plaything in Milpitas. So they were playing and I was sitting on a bench. It was hot, it was warm, but there was nice shade under the tree and not much disturbance. And I was just reading and these kids were playing. And just for that, hardly I sat for 5 minutes. But in that 5 minutes, I became conditioned to that place. I was even thinking, oh, this is such a nice place. I can even take a break from office and come here and sit and just relish this environment, nice trees around. And the next day I was seeing in the gas station, there were 2 workers. They were working hard. And then I was, you know, putting the gas in the car. And then they took the break. They took a break and they went and sat on a chair, 2 chairs and a nice table. Yeah, on the edge of their shop, under the trees. And they were happily smoking and drinking and enjoying life. And they would be probably thinking, this is what happiness is. This is what I look forward to after a long, you know, spell of 2 hours, 3 hours of working hard. See how a living entity gets conditioned by thinking whatever state I am in is a happy state. Many times in our childhood also, you know, if you have children, you get that experience. They would be watching on laptop something and you say, why are you watching it on laptop? I'll take you to movie. You can watch it on the big screen. It's a really nice experience. You can watch it in 3D. The same movie, I'll take you to 3D. And then the child starts crying. Father says, no, you stop the laptop, you close it, you get ready, you eat breakfast, you take bath, then I'll take you. No, it'll take a long time, I want to watch here. But Father is promising a higher happiness, much greater happiness than the child can ever get out of his own sense of conditional happiness. But the child cannot see the bigger picture. He is holding on to whatever conditions that he is feeling happy with. And anything you do out of it, it feels distress for him. Sometime back I was reading an article written by a devotee. It was titled as, The God Who Closes Doors. It was a negative title, but very intriguing title. The whole point was, how Krishna apparently closes our doors. When we are looking forward to something, Krishna closes the door. And then we are forced to go on to another path. But if you have faith in Krishna's intervention, Krishna's plan for you, there opens a bigger path. There opens a better path, which you cannot even, could not have even comprehended that such a path existed. Such an option existed. Just like if the child became faithful on the father, whatever the father does is good for me. Let me close the laptop. Let me see what is there, higher happiness. So it's important for devotees not to get conditioned by material atmosphere. Even Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur was so depressed, so disappointed with his own disciples sometimes, who would be fighting for their own rooms in his temples. I want this room, I want that room. And he was so disgusted that he felt like selling off all the marble that he had for the buildings and print books. In Chaitanya Charitamrita, there is a very instructive pastime of Raghunath Das Goswami showing as an example how to not be limited by conditioning. Even when we become devotees, even when we accept the path of renunciation, there are Maya's tricks which can come as a conditioning kind of happiness, where we can get to a corner and be satisfied. So when he went to Chaitanya Mahaprabhu after escaping from his house, going through all the forests, so Chaitanya Mahaprabhu hands him over to Swarup Damodar Goswami, his secretary. So it's in Puri, Jagannath Puri, all this is happening. So he is called as Swarupas Raghunath, because there are already Raghunath Bhatta Goswami. So Raghunath Das Goswami is called Swarupas Raghunath. And so he is given remnants of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, because he looked very weak and tired. So he happily honors the remnants. And so that became a custom. So every time Chaitanya Mahaprabhu would have his prasadam, they would bring the remnants to Raghunath Das Goswami. And it continued for a few days. And then Raghunath Das Goswami thought he is, you know, taking it too easy, against the instructions of renunciation given by Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. And so suddenly he disappeared. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu asked Swarup Damodar Goswami, "Where is Raghunath Das Goswami? I don't see him taking the remnants anymore." And then Swarup Damodar Goswami says, "He felt that he was just enjoying opulent life, having your remnants. So he wants to work hard. So he is going outside the Simhadwara of Jagannath Mandir in Puri, and he is." Just, so these people, the pujaris, they would come out with Jagannath Prasad, and they would give to people who are distressed, who are in need, and they would just give it and then go. So Raghunath Das Goswami was just standing, awaiting the mercy of Jagannath. And so that's how he is able to get his Prasad. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu felt happy. So my devotee is not becoming dependent, becoming conditioned by a particular situation. He is trying to become more and more Nanda. And after some time, he stops doing that also. In Simhadwara, waiting for Prasadam to come to Simhadwara. And he starts going to begging Madhukari at people's houses. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu asks Swarup Damodar Goswami, "What happened to Raghunath? I don't see him in front of Simhadwara." So Raghunath Das Goswami says, "No, he stopped waiting there and instead going to begging." And again, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu approves that. He says a very interesting and a very strong statement. He was acting like a prostitute, waiting in front of Simhadwara, waiting for a customer who would come and who would satisfy his wishes. So he was waiting for the Mahaprasadam to arrive. And then his, in the mind, he was expecting some kind of, you know, happiness to come like that for his own sense gratification. So it is better, he gave up that tendency, instead went and depended on the Lord to reciprocate through the instruments as householders to get some prasad for him and to live in a simple way. And meanwhile, his father, Govardhan Majumdar, he figures out he escaped and came to Puri, and they have given up hope that he would ever come back. So he would send some servants and money to Raghunath Das Goswami. But initially Raghunath Das Goswami wants to reject it. But then he thought, I would use it in the service of the Lord. So he would get the money and he would procure all the vegetables and cook nicely and invite Chaitanya Mahaprabhu for prasadam. And at least twice a month he would do that. Lavish prasadam he would cook and he would invite. And so after some time he stops even that. And Chaitanya Mahaprabhu asked, why did he do that? And then he finds that Raghunath Das Goswami felt that he was feeding Chaitanya Mahaprabhu with the earnings of a materialist, a householder, a materialistic person. And therefore it was contaminating the mind of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Or anyone who takes help from a materialist and feeds himself will get contaminated by the mind of that materialist. That's why Chaitanya Mahaprabhu also many times, he did not give audience to the king, Prataparudra. Because he felt that, it is Shastric injunction, that a sannyasi or brahmachari should not meet with a materialist. Nishkinchanasya bhagavat bhajanon mukhasya param param jigamishor bhavasagarasya sandarshanam vishayinam adhayoshitamcha hahanta hanta vishabhakshanatopya sadhu. So his instruction was, a person who is endeavoring for self-realization, and especially a sannyasi or a brahmachari who is called Nishkinchanasya, Bhagavat Bhajanon Mukhasya, who is engaging in the devotional service of the Lord sincerely, Paramparam Jigamishor Bhavasagarasya, who is trying to cross this Paramparam, this world of Bhavasagara, and go to this Parampadam. Sandarshinam Vishayinam Atha Yoshitamcha. To even see Sandarshinam, or meet. Vishayinam means those who are addicted to sense gratification. Material. A king is the highest representative of material enjoyment. Or Yoshitam, or the association with women. Sandarshinam Vishayinam Atha Yoshitamcha. Ha hanta hanta vishabhakshana topya sadhu. He says, it is better to knowingly consume poison than engage in this. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was very strict. But because Raghunath Das Goswami, he felt that Raghunath Das Goswami may feel bad. So he was honoring the prasadam. But he felt happy by learning that Raghunath Das Goswami stopped taking even that. And stopped inviting Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. You know what Raghunath Das Goswami was doing after that to collect prasadam? He would go outside the Simhadwara, not Simhadwara, the place where they wash the behind, the temple, where they throw away the remnants of prasadam, where there is this Anand Bazaar. If he had gone to Jagannath Puri, they sell this prasadam in a place called Anand Bazaar. And they dispose of all the, you know, prasadam gets spoiled and it washes off from the back And it is said that even the cows don't touch them, those discarded ones. So Raghunath Das Goswami would go, would collect that discarded refuse of the prasada, and he would wash all of that, so that you know the inner core of the grains, which is a little bit uncooked, he would get that, dry it, put some little salt, and he would take that as prasada. And then Swarup Damodar Goswami observes it, and he says, "What is this nectar of gods that you are having? Let me have it also." And then he is very protective. He doesn't want the devotees to have that, highly renounced kind of prasada. And Chaitanya Mahaprabhu also finds out. He goes there. "I heard that you are having some nectarian prasadam every day. What is that nectar? I want to see. I want to taste." Raghunath Das Goswami says, no, this is not fit for you, my lord. You should not have this." Chaitanya Mahaprabhu grabs it and takes a mouthful. And he is about to take another fist of prasadam, and he stops by falling on his feet. "No, you should not have this." And Raghunath Das Goswami doesn't stop there. His renunciation is so much. Actually, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu gifts him, by looking at his progress, red color seeds, gunja. I think in Telugu it's called guri gunja, something like that. Red color seeds with black dots. That gunja seeds mala, Shankaranand Saraswati, he gifts it to Chaitanya Mahaprabhu along with a Govardhan Shila. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu worships them with his heart and soul. He considers the Govardhan Shila as Krishna and this Gunja Mala as Radharani. So he worships them very nicely. And then, becoming pleased with Raghunath Das Goswami, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu gifts them to Raghunath Das Goswami, and who takes them again and worships them with his heart and soul. And the Govardhan becomes very dear to Raghunath Das Goswami, and he actually moves his residence near Govardhan Hill at the bank of Radhapur, where he would eat only once in 2 days, not also a piece of butter, and he would offer 1,000 obeisances to the deities and 2,000 obeisances to the devotees who meet him on a daily basis, all by not having any of the prasada. And by the way, today is Ekadasi. So the point is, the devotee, this pastime of Raghunath Das Goswami serves as an example of how the devotee does not wish to remain conditioned in any stage. The six Goswamis, they were so careful and cautious that they were not staying under a tree for more than one day, because they thought that they would get conditioned to that kind of happiness. In fact, there was a small pastime in Ramanuja's history, where he wanted to quell that conditioning from his disciples. So he said, one of his disciples, a new brahmachari, he said, "You go and do this thing in the ashram." So in the ashram, they would be hanging clothes, all these brahmacharis. And they have a particular place, each brahmachari has a particular place, they would hang their own clothes. Like that, different places. So he said, "You go and mix up all these clothes when they are in the ashram, inside quarters." So he would go and mix up all these different clothes. And then they would get up and take bath and get ready to wear their clothes. And then they would find that somebody else's clothes come into his place, and it's all messed up. And now it starts a chaos. Everybody shouting with each other, "Why did you have to put this here? This belongs to me. Why did you take my cloth?" So, and then Ramanujacharya shows them At the same time, he also exhibits the exemplary behavior of another grihastha, where he sends the same devotee and asks him to steal from the house of the grihastha. And when he goes inside, the husband would not be there. The wife will be there sleeping. And this devotee, for the instruction of Ramanujacharya, he steals the jewelry from the bangles from the wife. And suddenly she turns the other side. And then out of hurry and becoming scared, he jumps out of the window. But he would be watching for the instruction of Ramanujacharya. And then the husband comes. And then the husband finds out that the wife is actually watching that how he has been stealing. She says that, this person so and so, our Acharya's disciple has come and he was trying to steal. And then I turned the other way and then he ran away. And then the husband becomes disturbed. Why did you have to turn? Why did you have to disturb? Would have let him steal the whole thing on your whatever you are wearing. Guru Maharaj would have been in some need. Why did you have to do that? And then she says, no, that was my intention. He was finding difficult to steal the bangle from my other hand, so I turned the other way so that he can steal from this hand also. And he was hearing all this person who was hiding. And then he goes and relays the whole information to Ramanujacharya. And then he says, he uses this example to tell how it is important for a devotee to not be conditioned in any state, to properly be renounced. When Raghunath Das Goswami was exhibiting all this, he asks for instruction from Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, whether he was going on the right path. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu gives some beautiful instructions in Chaitanya Charitamrita. Let me read those few verses that he gives to Raghunath Das Goswami. So he says, तथापि आमराग्नाय श्रद्धाय दीहाय आमार्ये वाक्ये तबे करीह निश्चय. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is saying to Raghunath Das Goswami, nevertheless, if you want to take instructions from me with faith and love, you may ascertain your duties from the following words. So this is the start of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's instruction. This is in Antyalila, chapter 6, verse 236. ग्राम्य कथा न सुनिबे ग्राम्य वार्ता न कहिबे भालना खाइबे आर भालना परिबे. So what he is saying, do not talk like people in general or hear what they say. You should not eat very palatable food, nor should you dress very nicely. अमानि मानदहन कृष्ण नाम सदा लबे Vraje Radha Krishna Seva Manase Kalibe. Do not expect honor, but offer all respect to others. Always chant the holy name of Lord Krishna, and within your mind, render service to Radha and Krishna in Vrindavan. So what is the instruction? Who can recollect?
Amani Namani.
Yes, do not expect honor. Amani Manadahana Krishna Nama Sadalabe. What does it mean? Always chant the holy name of Krishna. Vraje Radha Krishna Seva Manase Karibe. With in mind, always render service to Radha Krishna. The previous verse was Gramya Kadha Na Sunibe. Gramya Kadha means do not. Talking nonsense. Gramya Varta Na Kahive. Do not talk like people in general or hear what they say. Bhalna Khaibe or Bhalna Paribe. You should not eat very palatable food, nor should you dress very nicely. So, of course, we should See how Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is giving instructions to different people. So he is instructing to Raghunatha Goswami in particular, who is a renunciant. And here he is saying, 238,
Eita sankshepe ami kailun upadesha swarupe ratthani ihar paive visesha.
I have briefly given you my instructions. Now you will get all details about them from Swarup Damodara Goswami.
Trunadapi sunichena taroriva sahishtuna amanina manadena kirtaniya sadahari.
That is where this is from. One who thinks himself lower than grass, who is more tolerant than a tree, and who does not expect personal honor but is always prepared to give respect to others, can very easily always chant the holy name of the Lord. So we'll stop here. Any other questions, comments on what we discussed today? So for householders also Chaitanya Mahaprabhu gives instruction. That was interestingly to Raghunatha Goswami when he was a householder. So let me read one or two such instructions. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu says, you should execute your household duties nicely, externally acting as if you are immersed in your household affairs, being attached to your household affairs, but internally being very renounced. So he meant Raghunatha Das Goswami to go back. He was trying to escape and come back from his house. You go back and take care of all your household duties. Don't act like a Markata Vairagi. Markata Vairagi means false renunciant, monkey renunciant. So monkey may look renunciant by looks, not wearing clothes, eating only fruits, but it is the number one rascal. So try to cleanse yourself by going through your householder stages, by keeping Krishna within your heart, chanting holy name of the Lord, and executing all household duties. So that was the instruction he gave. So of course, in general, we have seen Prabhupada writing volumes of instructions for householders. It's there in Bhagavatam, Chaitanya Charitamrita. The point is, we are not like the Mayavadas where it is required to be renounced to enter the bhakti path. From wherever we are, we can practice bhakti path. So we should, from whatever tradition we are in, the important thing is chanting the holy name of the Lord and doing whatever we can in whatever stage we are in towards Krishna consciousness. So these are standard instructions. So any other questions?
Srimad Bhagavatam ki jai, Srimad Prabhupada ki jai, Sai Guru Premande.